All right. Hi, guys. My name is Melody with McMillan Running. I'm here today with the one and only Coach Greg McMillan, my boss, coaching mentor, and friend, to talk about his new book, Running Nirvana, which just came out last month. So, Greg, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much. Always wonderful to talk to you.
Yeah. So you are in Arizona now, which maybe not everybody knows. So where are you based out of now?
I live in Scottsdale, Arizona, which is just outside of Phoenix. So sort of summer year round.
Very hot. I don't envy you, but I know you like running in the heat. So you already have a couple of books out. You Only Faster and Surviving the Marathon Freakout. So what really sparks the framework for Running Nirvana? What would you tell some of our veteran McMillan fans, or maybe a new McMillan fan, kind of about what Running Nirvana is for you?
Well, You Only Faster was really focused on the training plan. It was about how to take a training plan and tweak it to better fit you and your type. So the entire book is really going through that process of manipulating a training plan when you're setting it up so that it will fit you better. But that left out, how do you actually train? How do you manipulate it as you train? So a lot of the things that coaches do as we're kind of implementing a training plan, those lessons were not in there. And so I said, well, we need a book that kind of talks about how can you execute your training plan? What are the decisions you have to make really on a day-to-day basis to make that training better? And then also, what are the other things, the sort of one percenters that we talk about, the core, the strength, the mobility, the mental training, the nutrition, all of those things that weren't mentioned in You Only Faster. It was a little bit, we needed a little bit more of a comprehensive book to talk about, okay, what are the lessons that I'm talking about virtually every day with runners that help them get more from their running, and therefore they get more of those sort of, and that's why it's Running Nirvana. It's like those runs where you're like, oh, I feel so good, and I feel like I'm flying, and it's effortless. You can have more of those runs if you understand how to execute your training plan. So that was really the impetus, was I just kept saying, I've got all these lessons about every aspect of not just run training, but these other things like nutrition. I need to put that in a book so athletes can kind of self-coach themselves as they're implementing their training plan.
Yeah, I think it's a real package deal in the book. There's so much knowledge and information in there. In your book, you hit six different pillars of performance, running, prehab, form, nutrition, brain, and racing. To kind of provide all those tips that you were talking about to runners to tweak their training. But what are some tips maybe to help a runner just trust themselves to make those tweaks? You know, it's so hard when we're doing something big like a marathon, training for a marathon, just really to trust ourselves, especially if we're new to it, if we've never run before, or it's a new distance, something like that. What are some of those things that you can do to help people trust themselves?
Well, that has been a really big challenge, particularly because a lot of us runners, we're kind of type A. We if it's on the paper, we want to do it. We're driven. We have our goals and we feel like I do A plus B and I'll get to C. But of course, we're living organisms. So it doesn't quite work that way. We've got lives. We've got so many things that impact our training. And one of the things I'm really working on with athletes is that process of understanding the training is not set in stone, and it has to flow with your life as things happen from day to day, as things change. And that your willingness, and to your point, your sort of openness to making those changes, which is what a coach would do. If I were to meet you every day, the first thing I'm going to say is, how are you feeling? And you're going to tell me, and I'm going to make a decision. Are we going to do today's training as planned? Or are we going to make some adjustment? And so a lot of what I'm doing with athletes is getting them to trust that process, understanding that even for the Olympians that I've coached, we're always adjusting the training. We never execute the training exactly as it's planned because life gets in the way. You have to make adjustments. So a lot of the work that I do, particularly with goal-driven athletes, is to say, yes, you do have to work hard. Yes, you have to be disciplined. Yes, you've got to do the work, but you got to do it in a smart way. And sometimes we can be our own worst enemy in that we get a little bit too caught up in, I've got to do this, even though that little voice in our head is saying, you know, my hamstring's a little tight. I probably shouldn't do this workout, but you go ahead and push yourself. That's where you get away from running Nirvana. That's where you're moving toward an injury cycle that we're trying to avoid. So I do feel like for runners, it is a big sort, almost an aha moment when they realize that it's okay to adjust your training. That doesn't mean you're failing in your execution of the training. It actually means you're doing it the right way. You're working with your body and what you're getting. And as a result, you find you have fewer of those kind of bad workouts, injuries start to go away, and then you build this great momentum in training. So it is a big challenge with a lot of runners. And I work on that all the time. It's just like, yes, we're going to adjust and that's the way it is. And a lot of times when they hear me tell them, then they kind of cut themselves some slack and say, okay, this is the way it is. Part of the book is like educating them. This is how you do it. And you need to feel comfortable doing it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think that was really important to read throughout the book. Another thing you talk about in the book is seasonality to running, which I think a lot of people don't necessarily think about all the time. But how have you noticed seasonality even in your own running? I mean, you've been a runner for a really long time. How have you noticed that affect your training or your mindset over the years?
Yeah, it's interesting because running sometimes is counterintuitive. You would think I want to be as fit as I can all the time, but it doesn't quite work that way. We have these energy systems and even our mental systems that need a break. We kind of operate really well on sort of an on-off system, like a stress-rest cycle. We talk about that all the time. Yeah. You train, then you recover. And in the recovery, that's where you get the big benefit. And then you train again. The same thing can be applied to your running year, your running career, in that there can be that seasonality. There are periods where it's like, okay, I need to back away from the really hard training and allow some other things in my life to take over. And then for me, for example, like you mentioned, I like it when it's hot and humid. I like it when it's warmer. So for me, that's a time when I can really put my best training in. Whereas when it's cold, and it's dark outside more, and I just don't have that same motivation. So I have to use strategies like, okay, making sure I've got a training partner to meet up with so I get out the door, even though I don't want to. The same thing with your fitness. You can't be sort of in race-specific training all the time. You will plateau your fitness, you'll burn out, you'll get injured. And that's why you see even the pros, they have periods of time where they're really building a lot of fitness, training very hard. And then they have those relaxation times where they're recovering, building their base, and then they go again. So for a lot of new runners, I have to educate them that it's kind of a cycle and we're going to flow. So there we'll have some periods of the training year that's going to be really intense. You're going to have to kind of be selfish and make your running a high priority. Yeah. And then there'll be periods where that's not the case and you'll back off. And maybe we'll work on some other aspects of your fitness that will help you when we go into our next race-specific training. A lot of times athletes need to get stronger. They need to be more injury resistant. So we need to work on that kind of in the off season so you're better able to train. So again, just like day to day, there is this sort of yin yang, this up and down, this flow to training. And you always want to be in a situation where you're setting yourself up for improvement. You can't train hard all the time or that just doesn't happen.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you talked about just a minute ago, just having some of that accountability to get out the door on a, you know, cold wintry day. So what are some of your own personal motivational strategies? Like what's one personal example of a time that you've needed to motivate yourself? And then what are some strategies for maybe a beginning runner and an advanced runner? Kind of those three things. So start with your personal strategies and then we'll bump on from there.
I feel like I've kind of gone through all of those in my running career for sure. A lot of times, you know, certainly if I have a race coming up, the race becomes the motivator. It's, I know I need to get out. I need to do the work because I have these goals. And that's somewhat the easy part, I feel like, is when a race is getting close or you're racing frequently, I feel like that's when I stay motivated, for example. Yeah. And I like to race a lot. And so for me, having kind of frequent races once every 3 to 5 weeks, even within a training cycle that's building toward an A race or a big goal race, that to me is a great way for me to stay motivated. even if I'm maybe getting a little fatigued from the training, or maybe, you know, it's busy in my life or whatever, that kind of keeps me getting out the door. Then I've had those other times, like I mentioned, where I know I've got to be meeting up with people. I have to have them to keep me sort of on track to do my thing. Sometimes it's the logbook. You just say, okay, this week, this is a win for me, which is getting out the door 3 or 4 times a week for just a run. That's a win. Okay, that helps me kind of get that in. So you just have to develop whatever kind of works for you. Some people, you know, will have something posted on their mirror that reminds them every day why they're doing what they're doing. Whatever works for the person is what you kind of go with. I think that can be quite helpful. For the new runner, I feel like the focus on the routine is the most important thing. So sometimes, you know, they feel like, oh, if I didn't do what the schedule said, or I couldn't do that, it's a failure. And I look at it as, no, all we're doing is make running part of your life. We're trying to learn how it fits in. Is it going to be 3 days a week? Is it going to be Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or maybe it should be Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday? Well, let's figure that out. And all we care about is just lacing them up and getting out the door. I don't care how far you go. If you go half the distance that was required, that's fine, because we're just trying to do a routine. So with new runners, a lot of times it's just about, let's just get it in. Let's just get out the door. Don't worry so much about, did you accomplish as much or as fast or whatever as was stated. That's the most important thing. With more experienced runners, then you're really just trying to figure out what pushes their buttons. Yeah. You know, some people respond really well to fear. And so it's like, oh, you got this big race coming up. If you don't do the training, you're going to fail. Yeah. And then other people, it's a lot more positive reinforcement. Like, you know, man, last week was awesome. Let's do another week like that. I believe you can do that. Let's just get this in. And that's going to be a real step forward toward your goals. So you kind of work with each individual and what might help them. But I do think that every runner needs to have a set of strategies for the low motivation times, for those times where it is tough to get out, because then you can fall back on that, because it can be very easy to just one missed day leads to two missed days, which leads to a missed week. And suddenly you're, wow, you got to kind of start over. So I do think that, and that's what we talk a little bit about in the book, right? Is like, come up with these strategies that you can use to maintain that motivation. You can lean on when it is that, like, well, I really need to go for a run, but I don't feel like going, but I know I should go. When you're having that debate, you can kind of lean back on these strategies.
Yeah, absolutely. And another big part of the book that you talk about is having a big, scary goal, kind of what you were saying a few minutes ago, to keep yourself accountable. But how do you teach big, scary goals in conjunction with just those small goals, like getting out the door that day? You know, how do you kind of marry those two concepts?
Yeah, everybody's a little bit different. My wife, she really, you know, the big scary goal is what really motivates her to get out the door. So for her, if she knows she's in a period where her fitness is going to lag, then it is signing up for something like a half marathon or a big trail race or something that she likes. But she knows she just can't just jump into that without the training. That's a great strategy for her to use. And that helps her with those small intermediate goals, because she will get out the door because she's thinking, boy, if I don't get this run in, I'm not going to be ready for that race. So for certain people, that can be a great motivator to get out the door. For me, that's not the case. Just having the goal is important enough. And it doesn't have to be some really outlandish goal. It can be a goal that I could easily, like I can run a 5K anytime. Yeah. But it might be, I want to race this 5K fast. That's enough for me. So everybody's a little bit different. I just think, again, think about you and what motivates you, what strategies can kind of help you to keep your momentum in your running. Because as you know, as a runner and a coach, if you get positive momentum going, everything else gets better. You eat better, you take care of your body, you're a happier person. People like to be around you more because you're not grumpy because you're not trained. You know, all these things kind of snowball. And that's why, you know, a big part of the book is this thrust of like, let's set up the training for success. Let's build that momentum, because all these other things get better and better. And that can snowball into taking you to a level that that might've seemed kind of a scary goal, but yeah. Now all of a sudden it's very doable. And we see that all the time in running. It can be done.
Yeah, absolutely. Another thing that you talk about kind of in the book is like this fluid goal setting where you have your goal, but it's, you have to be a little more fluid. And I think it goes back a little bit to that tweaking your training and stuff like that. So how do you make a goal, like a big scary goal, fluid to what's going on with your life or your, or anything?
Yeah. A lot of times what I'll do in training is I have a goal pace sequence, right? So I don't care what you set as the goal. You can be yeah. that big, scary yeah. goal at the outset. And then along the way, we're kind of got to have these checkpoints. We're going to yeah. have these workouts or tune-up races or some marker that's going to say, all right, is that goal doable or not? Mm-hmm. And that allows you, after doing two or three of those kind of marker workouts or races, to say, is that goal doable or do I need to tweak it a little bit? And we see that all the time with the McMillan runners that we work with, is that, you know, they set the goal and suddenly we're going, wow, you're starting to really hit these workouts. Maybe yeah. you can ramp it up a little bit. Let's yeah. let's kind of see if we can go a little bit faster. Maybe that goal is not challenging enough. And then of course you have the other where you're like, well, Boston qualifier is awesome. That's a great goal to have, but it's not looking like this cycle that's going to happen. Let's just try to make a step forward. And then the next cycle, it should be more doable. So having sort of goal pace workouts along the way, being open that, yeah, you set a goal, but there's no crystal ball to know for sure if you're going to do it. We have to rely on your training and your fitness. And then of course, making all the adjustments that you have to do based on life as you go. That's an important part of the plan.
Yeah, absolutely. And it kind of comes back to, I feel like, sort of even changing your mindset around training and just doing some things that help trick your brain into getting the workout done, if it's a hard mm-hmm. workout or anything like that. So I coach high school cross country and track, and here in Santa Rosa, Montgomery High School in Northern California. And one of the things that really works with my team when we have a hard workout coming up and they're all miserable about it because they know it's happening and they're wandering around, they're coming to practice like all depressed and like, oh man, we got to do this really hard workout today. And then we'll like bust out, hey, we're going to have popsicles after the workout. And everyone's like, whole mood changes. And suddenly it's like the best thing ever. And mm-hmm. they're just going to knock out this workout because they have a popsicle at the end. So what's your like popsicle trick for yourself or for some of your athletes when they're really down on themselves or really not feeling motivated? What's kind of the trick to switch the brain into getting ready for the workout?
Yeah, I feel like those rewards can be very helpful. So if there's something that maybe you're restricting or you're trying to reduce that's really you like a lot, then that can be a great reward for that workout. I love cheeseburgers and beer. Yeah. So for me, that's an awesome, like, man, I can't wait for my, you know, meal that I'm going to have after I do yeah. this workout. So everybody's a little bit different, but it's interesting, in the very first Olympic training team that I coached back in the early 2000s, yeah. I would notice that as the athletes, you could kind of see when they started to kind of accumulate fatigue mm-hmm. and they sort of, their mood would kind of drop and you can see that sort of, it's kind of wearing on them. We would load up the vans and we would go down to this burger joint and it would be, get a cheeseburger, fries, shake, whatever you want, just on a comfort meal. We would be laughing. I like to tell corny jokes or, you know, any of watching funny movies. I find that like a comfort meal and a funny movie yeah. are fantastic for lifting the spirits. So you just got to experiment and see, but having a reward and recognizing that when your mood is changing, you might need to do something that makes you feel better yeah. Is a really important way to kind of keep the momentum going. I know with those athletes, every time we did it and we would then go into the next series of training, mm-hmm. they were just in a better mood. They were just lifted. And so as a coach, I'm always looking at, what is sort of the mental state of the athlete? Yeah. What's their mood? And
yeah.
do we need to adjust or modify? And what can I do to kind of help that process? And you can do that yourself, right? You can mm-hmm. think about that reward or yeah. whatever it is to help you feel better. Because all you need to do is feel better. And then training picks up.
Yeah. And I think it's about checking your own mood too, kind of learning yourself a little bit more, not just as a runner, but as a person, to really kind of check where you're at that day. Like, what's going on in your life? What's going on with your mood? Mm-hmm. How can you kind of make some tweaks just there to move forward? Another thing you really talk about a lot in the book is spicing up your training, which I know personally for me has really been made a big difference over the last 5 or 6 years, switching from sort of being depressed that high school cross country and college cross country and track was all over, and switching more to longer distances and doing a half marathon, and then being excited about that, and then doing a marathon, and then another one. Just all those things, like really changing the distances, helped me really get back into sort of a training mode. So talk about some maybe anecdotes of some ways that you've been able to spice up either some of your athletes' training or your own.
Yeah, certainly for me. I mean, I was much faster when I was younger. And so, you know, every runner, as you age, you kind of reach that point where, you know, well, I'm not going to be that fast anymore. And so you do kind of come up with the tricks. Age groups help, right? So you can kind of see how you fit that way. But for me, it was like, well, I want to try trail running. Mm-hmm. I love it just to go out and do it. So maybe I'll race. And so the focus kind of shifted from trying to run a faster marathon on the roads to, well, let me try some trail racing. And that was successful. And I ended up being a national champion in the trail marathon. So it was that switch from just the grind of regular road marathons to the switch to the trail that made a difference to me. And you see that a lot with people. And we've seen it a lot over the last 20 years when we had the marathon boom and sort of everybody was just becoming like a serial marathoner, just kind of going from marathon to marathon. They suddenly kind of running almost lost the fun. It became like it was just sort of a burden at times. And with those athletes, we'd say, hey, let's pause training for a marathon. Why don't we go and try to get better at the 5K and 10K? Yeah. That training doesn't take as much out of your life. You'll be fresher. Your weekends aren't dominated by these long runs. And that sometimes can rejuvenate them. Sometimes going to the trails or vice versa, or doing a relay or doing anything that kind of, again, spices it up. Doing different types of training can make a big difference. See that a lot with athletes that come to me and they kind of plateaued physically as well as mentally. And we go, okay, well, let's go to some different type of training. Sometimes that'll give you a fitness boost, but for sure it will give you something kind of a new mental stimulus that works really well for athletes.
Yeah. And it's just a sense of accomplishment around a new goal. You know, maybe you know that you can crush your 5K time, but you don't know that you can complete a marathon, and then you do it. And then it gives you more confidence in a whole new way to sort of adjust your training in that way. What's a good way to stay really recovery driven? You're talking about getting older as an athlete, just all those different things, to stay recovery driven versus calendar driven, because we're all so calendar driven these days, whether or not it's with our running, but just with our personal lives and our work lives and balancing all those things and including training. It's like, gosh, it's hard to remember to put recovery above what's going on the calendar. So talk about some strategies for that.
That is a big challenge because we're trying to fit a lot in sometimes, and most of us have a full plate already. And then obviously if something happens, then the plate is overflowing.
Yeah.
But for me, I find a good strategy is train today so you can train tomorrow, train this week so you can train next week. And that kind of keeps people from making those silly mistakes that if they go back, they'll realize, oh, I did that workout on Thursday and I felt really good. And on Friday was my recovery day, but I felt really good. And so I ran a little faster. And then I went a little longer on Saturday and then was on the schedule. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, 2 weeks later, they've got an ache of pain that's becoming an injury. Yeah. So I feel like that focus on, you know, train today so you can train tomorrow allows you to be conservative in how you're approaching the training load. So I always kind of feel like training should be conservatively aggressive. So I like when the total volume of training and the frequency or number of days per week is conservative, something that you should be able to accomplish. It's not going to be a stretch to get that running in your week. That allows you that wiggle room for when stuff happens. Mm-hmm. And that also then allows you to be aggressive in the key workouts. So if you've got a marathon pace run coming up, you want that to go really well. You want to challenge yourself in that. So you're conservative in the other stuff so you can put your effort there. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that does help the mentality of like, okay, I gotta get ready for the big effort.
Right.
So in order to get ready for the big effort, you rest, you hydrate, your nutrition's good, you get a massage, you do all those kind of things. So you start thinking in this kind of like, you know, on off or hard, easy, or like less important, really important.
Yeah.
That's a great strategy for athletes to kind of keep it going. And so for me, injuries are the enemy number one. So it's all about, okay, don't do anything training that would risk your ability to keep training. Mm-hmm. For injury prone athletes, that's a great strategy to use. For those who don't get injured very often, it is more of like, I'm going to get the biggest fitness boost from these specialty workouts.
Yeah.
So control yourself on the other runs. Make sure you're really bringing your A game on those specific days. That's where you get the biggest bang. Sometimes that helps athletes put a little bit more focus on recovery. You know this as a coach, if you can get an athlete to recover faster and to a greater extent, the next workouts are going to be even better. So when you do have that focus of, okay, my big workout is done. Now, all I'm trying to do is get ready for the next big workout. And that encompasses all those things we talk about in the book, from nutrition to the mind, to all the things that can help an athlete kind of accelerate her recovery so she can have a better workout the next time.
Yeah, absolutely. And then another thing you talked about that I felt was really important that I don't think a lot of people talk about is just how different personality types affect training. And kind of what about people though, who kind of fall in between? You talk in the book about type A and type B runners, people who, you know, are a little bit more strict on their training and others who are a little more loose. What about the people who kind of waffle back and forth and go back and forth between those? Cause I found myself in that space sometimes where I'm like really diligent for a month or two. And then like we've talked about, life gets in the way, and then I fall into the type B runner, and then I go swing back to the type A runner. So how do you talk to people like that who kind of waffle between the two?
Yeah, again, it comes down to those strategies, right? Mm-hmm. So when you're in the type A mode, then you've got to have strategies to control yourself so that you don't get too intense with your training, or you're making training where it's not going to fit if life gets busy, and then you can start that stumble down the missing runs, missing weeks, et cetera. So that's important to have those strategies to remind yourself, hey, things are going good now. I want to make sure I can continue this. And then when you're in the other, where you have maybe fallen off and you're not running and you're not making it as much a priority as you should, that's where you got to lean on those strategies, whether it is, okay, I just want to be disciplined to get out the door, and just lacing them up and getting out the door. That's the win for today, even if it's not the 45-minute run that I had scheduled or whatever your strategy needs to be. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a lot of it too. And a lot of us are like that, where we're not one or the other. We're kind of a blend, and we do sort of move across the spectrum, kind of like a pendulum.
Yeah.
I think it is important to recognize that that's normal. That's not uncommon for that to happen. And that you do need different strategies, and you need to figure out, which one do you like the most? Mm-hmm. Which is the one that you care about? Mm-hmm. And let's focus on how can we maintain that in a sustainable manner. Mm-hmm. So it's fine. And we see this all the time with our McMillan athletes, right? They're on fire and they're really stacking. I'm just like, this is great. Yeah. We just got to keep doing this for 10 weeks, not three weeks. And so you have to figure out, like, okay, what's going to set myself up for success long term? Mm-hmm. And it might be that you have a minimum number of days running, which is doable even when life gets crazy.
Yeah.
And then you say, well, if life is not crazy, I can add on to that. And that's even better. Yeah. But at least I've got a minimum that I know I can maintain, and I'm not going to slip. I know as long as I just focus on getting that in, I can feel good and I can keep that momentum going. It's all about momentum. Keep the momentum going in training. That's really key.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I think that's really important. How do you develop runners, or how do you help runners develop their own mantra to kind of get through these types of situations where they need something to go back to, that posted on the mirror or whatever it is, to really get them out the door during times like that, when they're maybe waffling in between? What are some of those mantras that you help them come up with?
Yeah, I think it's important for people to think about, I mean, and almost everybody has something that motivates them, right? And so you're kind of leaning on that, Are you coming up? I like alliteration. So if it's to be, it's up to me. That's like my thing. I love that because that focuses me on you're in control. You're controlling the dialogue. You're controlling if you get out the door. Those things matter to me. So you're always trying to say, okay, you've got to have these strategies for getting out the door or maybe pushing yourself when you're tired, right? Because we know fatigue messaging sends negativity. So that has to be countered with a lot of positivity.
Right.
So you have to develop those and more exposure to situations where you need to practice those can help reinforce what works for you. So you kind of have to figure out what is something that you can think of when things do get tough. That can work for you. For me, it's a little alliteration things. For other people, it's like, I'm thinking about my nephew who was sick when he was young and he fought through this and now, you know, he's successful and happy and all that. So everybody's a little bit different. Get whatever works for you and make sure that you have that written down in some place that you can lean on and come back to. Because you have to, over time, really make those strategies on automatic pilot. Mm-hmm. So for me now, and of course, I've been training and racing for almost 40 years. I know I can lean on these sort of mental tricks when it's tough getting out the door, when I'm in a hard workout and it's tough, when I'm in a race and it's really, you know, challenging. I can lean on these things that I've learned work for me. Everybody's a little bit different, but you've got to know those strategies because as easy as the pros look running, right? When you see them running in the marathons, they look like they're jogging at 5 minute pace. They still have all these same emotions. They just have put themselves in that position so many times that they've developed really good strategies to battle the negative self-talk that comes in. Because that's a normal thing. Negative self-talk happens to everybody because that's the brain trying to protect itself.
Yeah.
And you're trying to say, no, this is okay. We can keep going. So you've got to kind of balance those two. I think that's really important. You know, one of the things I talk about in the book is the awesomeness journal.
Yeah.
And that is this, you know, you got to have some place to write down all of your great runs, all of your great races, those times when you were proud of yourself for just getting out the door, finishing that long run. Make a list of that. That's a great tool to come back to when that motivation is low or when you've got something big coming up that you're a little scared of, like your kids looking at that.
Yeah.
They remind themselves, you know, I am tough. I have gotten through these kinds of workouts before. Yeah. That's a brilliant way to, again, you just have to constantly build yourself up.
Mm-hmm.
You have to constantly fight sort of this negative tendency our brain has, you know, going. And you've got to go toward building more and more positivity because that's what coaches usually do. I mean, great coaches are motivators. They are helping athletes believe they can do something that they currently can't do.
Mm-hmm.
That's the role of the coach. And that's usually like this positive, you can do it, you can do it, which is battling the negative that the athlete often has.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think it's even funny just how some of those mantras, how sometimes other people's mantras can kind of get in your head too, I feel like, because I would spend a lot of time developing some of my athletes' mantras and helping them kind of come up with words that meant something to them to chant before the, you know, the start line, the finish line and all that. But then I was doing my last marathon and I was in that last 10K and, you know, that's always the fun part of the marathon. And I found myself just chanting one of my athletes' mantras that she would always say at the beginning of the line that she was yelling to everybody, like, the faster you run, the faster you're done.
That's right.
And I was like trying to get through the last 6 months. All right, like, faster I run, the faster I'm done, as I'm slogging through that last 10K.
Yeah.
All
it's
those
really interesting. Whatever works for you, right?
Yeah.
You just got to have something. But the main thing, as you mentioned, is you have to have something.
Yeah.
You can't go into it thinking you're not going to need that. You're always going to need it. You need it in your training. You need it in your racing. So you've got to develop those strategies. And once you kind of work through and figure out what works for you, you've really got something to lean on during the tough times. And typically then you'll have a better experience. You'll be more proud of yourself because you got the most out of yourself on that day. You didn't give in. You didn't sort of have a pity party. That's really helpful, I think, of keeping that positive momentum.
Well, and I think even breaking it down into even just sections on the race and having a different mantra for each section of the race too, I think is really critical, especially depending on whether it's a new distance for the runner or something they haven't done before, to really do little bite-sized pieces of having like, okay, this is my mantra for the first 5K. This is my mantra for the next 5K, and really kind of build on that. Or you can just do like everybody used to do like 5 years ago when all those Ryan Gosling memes were everywhere and all over. You just put a different Ryan Gosling meme on every little section of the course. And then for women anyway, that seemed to work for a while. So that was a huge thing, definitely.
Well, you know, in the book, we talk about having a thinking plan.
Yeah.
It's interesting for races because people come up with a pacing plan. They know, like, I want to hit these splits or whatever. And they think, oh, well, the race course has got this hill or whatever. But a big part of it is, how do you want to think? Because you control the dialogue in your mind, right? Nobody else is control. You have control over your conscious thoughts. So think about how you want to think.
Yeah,
I think that's a really good strategy going into races. I know for me, when I won that national championship, it was a hilly course. So you climb for the first 8 miles, kind of arduous on this single track trail, climbing up to over 5,000 feet altitude. And then you kind of rolled along until 20 miles. And then you do this really steep downhill technical to the finish.
Yeah.
Just when you didn't want any more pounding on your legs. Now you've got to do that. So I had different strategies for those different sections, like you mentioned. And that's very helpful. So I thought about how I wanted to think. So I was conscious about, I was going to control the dialogue throughout the race, instead of just sort of going along. And then all of a sudden, you know, your mind starts throwing in these fatiguing messages or messages of doubt, or a lot of times kind of negativity. You already were controlling the dialogue. The more you do that, then you give yourself a better chance of kind of combating those thoughts that can lead to not being as successful as you want to be.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's talk a little bit about some other racing strategies, because you had a couple in your book. One of them was to let go early and latch on later. Can you tell us a little bit about like what that means and what
that means? Patience in racing is important. And I think for us, that those of us that are kind of performance driven, goal driven, type A or whatever, it's, you know, early in races, it can, you can get drawn into somebody else's pace. You can get competitive with somebody early and they can kind of take you off of your plan, your strategy that you know is successful for you. So and I always felt like early in races, you really have to let everybody else do their own thing. So if you're with somebody and they're going to go faster than you should, you know, you should, or doesn't fit into your plan, you let them go. Don't worry about them. But in the second half of the race, and somebody comes by you, latch on. That's kind of your person that's going to tow you down the line. Cause that's when you know it's going to get hard. And that's where any help to get you to go faster is really important. In fact, in my personal best marathon, which was that California International Marathon, I was feeling really bad at about 22 miles, as you often do, but I was running fast. I was kind of struck, and this guy came by me, and I thought for a split second, and then I said, no, latch on, latch on to him. He's feeling really good. He's going to tow you. And that helped me get closer to the finish line. I just sort of followed him. I used him as like my, he was on, kind of that rubber band between us and he was pulling me. That was a great strategy. Even though I was fatigued, it pulled me along, and I know I was running faster than if I had just let him go and I was by myself. So that concept is really like, run your own race in the beginning, but then utilize the competitors later to latch on, so they pull you to that finish line. They're helping you bring more out of yourself. It's a great strategy for younger runners who get a little over exuberant at the beginning of races and then struggle later. It's also for those of us where we can kind of have those pity parties later. It's like, no, use everything to help you get to that finish line faster. That's a great strategy. I've used that for forever, where early on, I'm just like, hey man, you go do your thing. If that's your pace, that's your pace. It's not mine. And then later it's like, great, this person, whether it's, you know, they're in front of me and I'm going to catch them and latch on that way, or they come by and I latch on. Either way is a great racing strategy.
Oh, it's so helpful for sure. You talk a lot about the McMillan calculator in your book, as far as some of these race predicting things and stuff like that. But I don't know if a lot of people really know how the McMillan calculator came about, kind of what your thought process was, and the fact that we've kind of like updated it recently and there's some fun new features on it. But maybe tell a little bit of the history of just kind of your thought process around that, and give us a little background.
Well, I was really lucky. I've always coached a really wide spectrum of runners. I had some people that were much slower than I was and some people that was much faster than I was. So when you coach somebody that's of your similar ability, all the paces make sense. Yeah. But if you coach somebody that's a lot faster, or a lot slower, you don't know how does that pace feel to them, right? You only have your perspective. So I started using all the available tools to try to provide these paces to athletes so they were training optimally, but nothing seemed to kind of fit. And at that time I was in graduate school studying exercise physiology and doing this research on runners. I started to see, oh, there's these ways that you can, for no matter the athlete, you can tell them the precise range. As long as you're in this pace range, you're going to get the type of adaptation we want from it. So as a result, I kind of developed these strategies, and I still have it, but it was a big print, lots of Excel spreadsheet printouts. It was like, okay, this runner is a 3 hour and 49 minute marathon or so. This is what she should be doing for these different types of workout. Anyway, ended up converting that into the online calculator, which again, it was just for myself as coaching. I needed an easy way to be like, okay, I put this person's in and I could tell them exactly what pace ranges to use. I could also say, okay, you did a 10K. What do we predict you can run in your half marathon? Right. It just was one-stop shop. I could just put in a little bit of information and get that. And of course, it's become more and more popular. We've added more and more features to it. We just updated its presentation, particularly on mobile, so it's even easier to use. But it really was a way for all athletes and coaches to get the athlete in a ballpark of what kind of effort she should be doing for the type of workout we want. Because that's what, you know, we're kind of prescribing the runs based on what we want the athlete to get from it, what adaptations she should get later after that training. So it was really a way to kind of narrow it in. And it's worked really, really well, because it just at least removes that, I don't know for sure. It's like, well, okay, start here. This is a good place to start and see how you feel. And then you can kind of manipulate within that. And it's up, it's free. You can use it. You know, it always will be free. And I'm so happy that runners and coaches have found it beneficial, because that's what I was using it for. I needed it to help me and my athletes to kind of like, I want to make sure you're training optimally.
Well, and I think it's a good tool also for people who aren't sure what they're capable of. If they have a shorter distance and they're thinking about a longer distance, and to plug it in and be like, oh, I could maybe run that time. Like, that's really cool. Like, I know it's been helpful for some of my athletes who don't believe me when I say, hey, you could run this. And then I'll send them there and they'll be like, oh, I guess maybe.
Sometimes you need somebody else to say it's possible, or show that it could be possible. And that's a good use of it as well.
Yeah. So talking about that, when's a good time for someone to get a second opinion on their training? And when is a good time to kind of just shut out all the voices and really follow your own instincts? Because I feel like it's so hard for some of us to either listen to too many voices or not listen to anyone. And so what are some strategies around that?
I feel like if your training and racing is improving, so you're getting faster, you're happy, you're not getting injured, everything is kind of going along nicely, don't change anything. Don't second guess. Just keep doing what you're doing, because it's working. When you do find that your racing performances are not in line with what you would expect from your training, or you're plateaued, so you feel like, man, I'm not improving, something's happening, or you're always getting injured or burned out. Those are times where you should look and you should say, something is not quite, the pieces of the puzzle aren't quite fitting. I've got some of it, but not the whole thing. Training in theory should feel challenging, but doable. It should be something that you can sustainably maintain across your training cycle, and it should lead to you being more motivated and getting fitter. If it's not doing those things, then that's where you need to look at it and figure out maybe the training just won't fit into your life schedule. So your life schedule is not going to change. So you probably need to change your training, or this strategy or this type of training you're doing doesn't fit you. So you need to modify and maybe do something different. But you're right. It can be. Everybody's got an opinion, and everything works. Right? People have been successful with all kinds of crazy training strategies. So you just have to come down to what works for me, what keeps me happy and motivated and improving. If that's working, don't change anything. But once it doesn't work, now's the time to start investigating why and what I might be able to change.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you, Greg. This was so informative. I feel like I always learn more every time we talk. So it's fun to get to do this. For those of you who don't know, the book is available on mcmillanrunning.com. And if you made it all the way to the end of this awesome interview, we're going to give you a little discount. It's going to be 10% off. So if you put in the code interview at checkout, you'll get 10% off the Running Nirvana book. So thanks so much, Greg, and I'll talk to you soon.
Sounds good. Thanks, Melody. Appreciate it.